All right, everybody, we're in Unit 8, page 43. We're going to talk about methods of sterilization. Steam, dry heat, filtration, and toxic gas are the four big categories. Autoclaving, sterilizing in place, flow through, and steam jackets are all forms of steam. A lot to talk about here, so let's get started. First off, you need to know the magic numbers, 121 degrees Celsius and 15 PSI gauge. The gauge is important because what it means is that it's basically the same atmosphere pressure, again, above what we already have. We're at 14.7 pounds per square inch. This is 15 pounds per square inch above what's already there. 121 is way above boiling, so under that high pressure, we can actually kill microbes, viruses, and spores, pretty much everything. Steam can be used to sterilize equipment, glassware, and liquids. There are four methods for steam sterilization: autoclaving, steaming in place, steam jackets, and flow-through sterilization. Autoclaving. Autoclaving is like a big kitchen pressure cooker or canner. It's good for sterilizing liquids in containers, small instruments and equipment, you need to know that, and glassware. Steam circulates through the jacket and into the chamber until the chamber reaches the desired temperature and pressure. Usually takes about 15 minutes is the minimum amount of time that you're allowed to use an autoclave for. Sterilizing in place. Big tanks are too big to move, so we have to sterilize them where we are. So basically we pipe in steam through there. As we pipe that steam in there, that sterilizes them in place. We can also do this using a sterilizing in place steam seal. Excuse me. So if here we have our media. The media is the liquid food for the fermentation tank, because remember, fermentation means basically to grow cells. So normally we would open up these two valves, A and B, and the media can pipe on through. Now, the problem is the media, the food, can become contaminated, and we don't want it to become contaminated, so we run it with a steam seal. In this scenario here, all of our valves are completely closed. When we steam in place, in order to help basically sterilize everything, we open up our steam valves, and we open up the valves that let this into the tank. Now, inside the tank, this can cause some problems. It can get too much pressure in there, or when that steam cools, it can actually cause a steam collapse. So we do have a drain valve open as well that helps prevent this. Condensation comes out through the drain valve, and we do open it periodically. It is throttled in order to help this steam go through. However, we have B closed because we don't want any media coming into this container. Once we are satisfied and we have met the requirements of the SOP that the fermentation tank is steam sealed, we then close off the steam as well as the drain and we pipe in the media. Now we have a freshly steamed pipe that the media can go in. It's nice and sterile, so we don't have to worry about it picking up any unwanted microorganisms and trying to grow them instead of what we want it to grow. And we push that stuff on in. Now, the interesting thing about a steam seal is once we pipe it in there, normally we probably think we close everything off and leave it at that, but no, we don't. We actually close off the media input valve. We also put the input valve for the tank. Those are both closed, but we do still open up the steam valve, keep this filled with steam, and then periodically throttle that drain valve to let any condensate go out and so forth. This may seem kind of strange, but we do this because this steam is high pressure and will push any contaminants away from this area. So it actually helps keep everything sterile, and this is what we call a steam seal. Okay, the steam seal protects the fermentation tank against contamination from a leaky valve, a break in the opening, or the accidental opening of valves. Page 47, we're talking about sterilizing with steam as well. Let me see if I go back. Yeah, we really don't have any of that. Some liquids are sterilized in a mixing tank or fermentation tank by heating them to the required temperature for a specified amount of time. We do have what's called flow-through sterilization. In flow-through sterilization, liquid passes through a heat exchanger. It heats the liquid up to the required temperature as it flows through. This method limits the amount of time that a heat-sensitive liquid is exposed to high temperature. So, flow-through sterilization is pretty important. For steam jackets and heat exchangers. And then last, under this little category here, we have sterilizing with dry heat. There's not much to say about dry heat, but dry heat is materials are usually placed in an oven or they sit through a dry heat tunnel or a conveyor. The materials stay in the oven at 170 degrees Celsius for 2 hours or less if the oven temperature is higher. This works really well for empty glassware, small instruments, and heat-resistant powders and oils. However, dry heat is not any good for liquids. I mean, it's dry heat, so you don't want to dry out the liquid. You don't want to use it for any plastics or rubbers either because it's going to melt the plastic and it's going to dry out the rubber. So dry heat is not good for any of those. On page 48, filtration is a form of sterilization. We do have filters that have ports that are so small you can't visually look at them and see that they're there. So in order to deal with them, we have to integrity test them. Integrity testing is usually where we take a filter and we apply a certain amount of fluid flow against one side and versus the other, and we look at the pressure on the high pressure side and the pressure on the low pressure side, and we are supposed to see certain numbers in between. If the pressure difference is not appropriate, then that lets us know that there's actually a tear in the filter, that the holes are too big, and in that case, we need to throw the filter away and get a new one. And probably not just throw it away in the garbage. You probably would get rid of this as like a biohazard because it is contaminating. It is intended to contain microbes. And then we have sterilizing with toxic gas, which I think they don't actually have a slide for. Some things are damaged by high heat. They're often sterilized with toxic gases. Manufacturing areas may be fumigated with disinfectants in a vapor or aerosol form. And these gases and aerosols can harm humans as well as kill microorganisms. So we do have stringent safety precautions in place. On page 50, 51, 52, 53, there is a brief lab that I normally do like to do. I'm not sure if we're going to get to do it because it takes a lot of time to do it. Basically, you mix up some media and you sterilize it in an autoclave. You take some, you don't sterilize it in an autoclave, some you do. Then you take both liquids, you put them in an incubator and leave them for a couple of days and see what happens. After incubation, what you find is that the one that's not sterilized tends to get turbid. That means it gets cloudy, whereas the one that gets autoclaved is usually clear. And the one that's been autoclaved will stay clear because the autoclavin actually killed any microbes that were living in the liquid media. And then unfortunately, I never get to do the filtered because I don't have the materials to do the filtered, but the filtered should also stay clear as well. Okay. And we're going to stop there on page 55.